purchase of God, born of his spirit, washed in. Thank you.
we'd like to invite you, wherever you are around the world, to raise your voice and get in on singing together Psalm 150. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord.
You made the starry host. You traced the mountain peaks. You paint the evening skies with wonders. The earth, it is your throne. From desert to the sea, all nature testifies your splendor. Praise the Lord.
Hi, Pastor Tim Peck here. You know, a lot of people don't know my birth name was Tim Brown. I didn't become Tim Peck until I was about 7 years old when my mom's second husband, Mike, adopted me. And though I didn't know it at the time, that may be part of the Peck family story. It's a great story, a story about immigrating to America from England, a story about abolitionists who helped run the Underground Railroad and pastors who followed the gold rush to California. It's a story where one of my ancestors, Sedley Peck, was one of the first to discover gold in the East Fork of the San Gabriel River above Glenkirk here. I became a part of the Peck family story when I was 7, but I really didn't appreciate the story until much later. When we trust in Jesus, we're brought into the Bible's story of the people of God. And this story may not be ours by blood, but it becomes ours by faith. No part of this story is more important than the story of the Exodus. It's a story about how God's people were slaves in Egypt and God raised up Moses to confront their oppressor, the Pharaoh. The story of how God led them out of their slavery, parted the Red Sea, and brought them into freedom. It's a story how this group of former slaves became a covenant community that would eventually bring Jesus to the world. Through Jesus, we're brought into this very story. During the season of Lent, we're starting a new series here at Glenkirk called Welcome to the Story. And in this series, we'll spend 5 weeks talking about the Exodus story as our story. So I hope you'll join us on this live stream starting on Sunday, February 26th, for Welcome to the Story. God bless you and thanks for listening.
Hello, good morning, everybody. Many of you may know your regular worship pastor, Eric, is on vacation with his family, so I'm so happy to be back with you today, and this is my friend Norma who's joining us. So if you'd like to stand to your feet, let's begin with some worship songs today. next song we're going to sing together today is a song that's really near and dear to my heart. It has a simple chorus that says, I'm no longer a slave to fear, for I'm a child of God. And that's pretty much a sentence that summarizes my testimony, that I'm not going to share my whole testimony now, don't worry, but the Lord has brought me through so many instances of delivering me from fear. Fear was such a major stronghold in my life before I really knew who I was in Christ. The sentence, I'm no longer a slave to fear, I'm a child of God, is kind of one of those things that's easy to say, but harder to believe and to know in our knower and to let the revelation of God sink deep into our hearts that we've been adopted into His family, we've been given authority from Him, and that we have nothing left to fear because He's so powerful and because our hope is so eternal in Him. But when that really began to sink in my life, it changed everything for me. So I'm so excited to just declare these words, these truthful words today as a community, as the family of God, the adopted sons and daughters who've been set free and delivered by Him. So I just invite you, let's continue to worship Him and remember how powerful He is. God, it's our prayer today that this truth, this amazing revelation of your power to deliver would enter into our lives, in every area of our lives, that you'd bring more and more freedom as we grow in you, as we're discipled by you year after year, that you just take off these layers of trepidation or timidity or anxiety or unsure or just even wrong beliefs about our value and who we are in you, God. I pray for divine revelation to permeate every part of our hearts and our souls, that we're your children, that we're united with you, and I pray that that would begin to just revive your people around the world, that we'd rise up and that we'd live out your calling on our lives from the place of confidence in our identity in you. We pray these things in Jesus' amazing name. Amen. You can feel free to have a seat.
Good morning, everyone. We're so happy to have each and every single one of you here with us this morning. Whether you're here worshiping in person or worshiping online or from home, we would love to hear from you on one of our connection cards that can be found in the bulletin or online. You can also access the connection card, submit prayer requests, and request information through the Glenkirk Church app. Today is our quarterly food drive for Shepherd's Pantry. So please drop off your hygiene and non-perishable food items at the Circle Drive or here in the Worship Center. If you're interested in learning more about Glenkirk and becoming a member, please come to our Belong class at 2 p.m. this afternoon. The class will be held in room 22. Pastor Tim will lead the class covering the vision and values of our church. Our young adults group will meet today after second service for a free lunch. So meet Josh in the patio to caravan to the restaurant. And please feel free to invite and bring a friend. And lastly, join us for pancakes on the patio between services March 19th. High school students will prepare and serve pancakes as a fundraiser for their upcoming mission trip to Salt Lake City, Utah. The suggested donation is $5 a plate. And so now, if each of you are willing and able, I want to invite you to bow your heads with me and close your eyes as we dive into prayer. God, creator of the universe, maker of all things, as a community, we gather to give thanks to who you are. Even in the midst of the chaos and the tribulations that surround this world, we praise you, and we trust that your ways are higher than ours, even when we don't understand it. We thank you for gathering us here today to worship you. Lord, as we consider giving back to you, help us to do so with generous and joyful hearts. Help us to honor you and to remember that all we have is a gift from you. We now offer a portion of those gifts back to you. Please accept our offerings as good and pleasing in your sight. Help us be a community that shows your love to everyone we encounter, even those who mistreat us. We pray for the hurting, the sick, and the lonely. And we pray that we are able to be a community that shows these groups the same love you show us. We pray for our surrounding church communities and the church body as a whole. Help us all exemplify a church that encompasses your kingdom motive. We humbly ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So starting today, we will be passing the offering plate during services again. And you can place your offering in one of the envelopes that can be found in the pews, and you can turn it into the plate. And you can still also give on the Glenkirk website, the Glenkirk app, or using our text to give feature. Now as the ushers come forward to receive this morning's offering, let's worship God with thanks and praise for all that he's done for us. Be sure to also put your connection card in the offering plate as well. God bless you all.
And I will also throw in there, if there's any kiddos that are still in here, you're free, you're dismissed to go to kids' class.
Thank you.
invite you once again to stand as we sing one last song together. Let's sing it out. 'Tis so sweet.
'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take Him at His word, just to rest upon His promise, just to know the same. Trust Him, how I prove Him, Lord.
Feel free to have a seat once again.
Good morning. This is a yes and story. Those were the words my high school acting coach told me as I ignorantly disrupted a scene that my fellow classmates were putting on. It was my first lesson in improv, and I did not know what I was doing. If you aren't familiar with improv, it's short for improvisation, and it's a theatrical technique where the actors aren't given any lines or characters or location, and they have to come up with all of that on their own. They improvise the performance. So what anyone who has done improv will tell you is that in order for the scene to be successful, the actors have to work together and not shut down each other's ideas. Instead, they need to say yes to them and build upon them for the scene to progress. This is called the yes and principle, where each actor says yes to the ideas of the other, the characters they come up with, the lines, the scene, and they add their own things on top of that. I didn't know any of this. And as my fellow actor began the scene by saying something like, "Don't the mountains look majestic this morning?" I foolishly replied with something like, "What do you mean? We're in the middle of the ocean." Effectively, I was saying no to what they had put forward, and I was trying to do my own thing. But my acting coach kindly corrected me, said the story we are creating together is a yes and story. So instead of saying no, you need to say yes to what your actor puts forward and build upon it. A yes and story. The yes and principle ensures that what came before is not dismissed, but is seen as the foundation for what comes next. So my teacher showed me what this might look like. My classmate said again, "Don't the mountains look majestic this morning?" And he replied with something like, "Yes, but we don't have time to sightsee. We need to get to the ranger station before dark." That was pretty good, huh? I felt like my response ignored what my classmate put forward, but my teacher's response built upon it. This is a yes and story. This morning, we're in the second week of a 5-week series for Lent called Welcome to the Story, where we examine the story of Israel's escape from slavery in Egypt in the book of Exodus, and how that connects with our own story of freedom that Jesus brings to us. And to do this, we're looking at 5 parts of the Exodus story, which the New Testament directly connects to our experience of salvation through Jesus. Looking back at what God did for the people of Israel in Egypt, we can gain a better understanding of what it is God does for us through Jesus. Last week, Pastor Tim asked the question, "What is our problem?" And he pointed out that Israel's problem in the Exodus story is the root of the human problem, that we share in Israel's plight. Israel was enslaved in Egypt, and humanity is enslaved to the domain of darkness, to sin, evil, and death. But God redeems Israel from their slavery, and through Jesus, God redeems humanity from slavery to sin, evil, and death. So this week, we are looking at the second part of this story, the second way that the Exodus story connects to our own, the second way we are welcomed into this grander story of the people of God. So if you're able this morning, would you stand for the reading of God's word from Exodus 6 and Hebrews 3. Then the Lord said to Moses, "Now you will see what I will do to Pharaoh, Because of my mighty hand, he will let them go. Because of my mighty hand, he will drive them out of his country. God also said to Moses, I am Yahweh. I appeared to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob as God Almighty, but my name, Yahweh, I did not make myself fully known to them. I also established my covenant with them to give them the land of Canaan, where they resided as foreigners. Moreover, I have heard the groaning of the Israelites, whom the Egyptians are enslaving, and I have remembered my covenant. Therefore, say to the Israelites, I am Yahweh, and I will bring you out from under the yoke of the Egyptians. I will free you from being slaves to them, and I will redeem you with an outstretched arm and mighty acts of judgment. I will take you as my own people, and I will be your God. Then you will know that I am Yahweh, your God, who brought you out from under the yoke of the Egyptians, and I will bring you to the land I swore with uplifted hand to give to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. I will give it to you as a possession. I am Yahweh. And from the book of Hebrews, therefore, holy brothers and sisters, who share in the heavenly calling, fix your thoughts on Jesus, whom we acknowledge as our apostle and high priest. He was faithful to the one who appointed him, just as Moses was faithful in all God's house. Jesus has been found worthy of greater honor than Moses, just as the builder of a house has greater honor than the house itself. For every house is built by someone, but God is the builder of everything. Moses was faithful as a servant in all God's house, bearing witness to what would be spoken by God in the future. But Christ is faithful as a son over God's house, and we are his house, if indeed we hold firmly to our confidence and the hope in which we glory. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. So our Exodus passage sets up Moses as the one God has chosen to deliver God's people from slavery. Moses is God's chosen deliverer who will show the power of Yahweh to break the bonds of slavery for God's people. And in a similar way, the New Testament sets up Jesus as God's chosen deliverer who will show the power of Yahweh to break the bonds of humanity's slavery to sin, evil, and death. Moses and Jesus are set up as deliverers. And as a Bible scholar, James Hamilton, points out, the scriptures want us to make the connection between their stories. For there are many parallels. When Moses was a baby, the Pharaoh ordered all Hebrew baby boys in Egypt to be killed. When Jesus was a baby, Herod ordered all Hebrew baby boys in Bethlehem to be killed. Just as Pharaoh failed to kill Moses, so too Herod failed to kill Jesus. Moses, ironically, found safety in Pharaoh's own household when his daughter took him in. Similarly, Jesus found safety in the land of Pharaoh in Egypt when his family escaped when he was a baby. Moses led the people out of Egypt to the promised land, and similarly, Jesus' family left the land of Pharaoh, left Egypt to Israel, the promised land. Moses spent 40 years facing trials while wandering in the desert, and Jesus faced 40 days of trials while wandering in the desert. Moses ascended the mountain to bring God's law for the people, and Jesus ascended the mount to bring God's teaching for the people. In the Old Testament, Moses is the archetype, the primary example of the deliverer God chooses to bring redemption and freedom to God's people. And in the New Testament, we see that Jesus' story follows this archetype, follows Moses' example, to show that Jesus, too, is the deliverer that God uses to bring redemption and freedom to God's people. As theologian N.T. Wright points out, this exodus from slavery in Egypt is the pivotal moment in the Old Testament where God's power was shown. God's people were freed and were free to become a nation of their own. And the scripture sets us up to see these similarities between this story of Moses as deliverer and Jesus as deliverer, so that we would recognize in the story of Jesus that God was once again moving in a big way. God was once again doing something immense with immense power to free God's people from oppression in a way that God hadn't since the Exodus. God was once again raising up a deliverer. But Hebrews chapter 3 makes an important distinction between these two deliverers, between Moses and Jesus. The writer of Hebrews says that while Moses was honored, Jesus is worthy of more honor. While Moses was a faithful servant in God's house, Jesus is the Son of God, reigning over God's house in glory. In other words, you thought you saw a mighty deliverer in Moses, but you ain't seen nothing yet. For just as God so loved Israel that God raised up Moses to deliver them from slavery in Egypt, so God loved the entire world, that God sent Jesus, God's one and only Son, to deliver humanity from the reign of sin and evil and death so that whoever believed in him should not perish, but have eternal life. And this is the good news. This is the gospel that Jesus wants to bring freedom to us, to you and to me. Jesus is our deliverer. Welcome to the story. But there's another important piece to this, something I really don't want us to miss. Because I have heard some claim that our passage in Hebrews teaches us that we don't really need to pay much attention to the story of what God did through Moses, because now we have Jesus. Sure, Moses is given honor, but Jesus is worthy of more honor, so let's just put the story of Moses on a shelf. And I've heard this said either because the people claim that what came before Jesus doesn't matter, that we have the New Testament, so we don't really need to read the Old Testament, or they believe that we should put the story of Moses on a shelf because what Jesus did for humanity is mostly spiritual, that the freedom God brings through Jesus is mostly or only spiritual. But I'm not sure that's the right approach. And I'm thankful for various scholars like Esau Macaulay and James Cone that make this more clear to me. Because when I look at Hebrews 3, I think that we need to remember what I had to learn in that first improv class, that this is a yes and story, that God's story is a yes and story. And in a yes and story, what came before is not dismissed, but is seen as the foundation for what comes next. The deliverance God brought through Moses should not be dismissed, but seen as the foundation for the deliverance God brings through Jesus. I thought a visual might help. So, here we go. So in our Hebrews 3 passage, it says that Moses was a faithful servant in God's house. I'm not an artist, but here's God's house. And here's Moses in God's house. But it also says that Jesus Christ is faithful as the Son over God's house. So here's Jesus over God's house. And we, the people who believe, are God's house. So Jesus being over God's house doesn't mean that Moses is no longer in there. It doesn't mean that Moses somehow gets thrown out. Jesus being over God's house means that all that Jesus did and does for humanity includes and implies what Moses did. It's greater than it, but what God did through Moses is still a part of it. This is a yes and story. What came before is not thrown out, but seen as the foundation for what comes next. And we must not lose sight of this. I think it's really important because through the story of Moses, we learn something really important about the character of our God. That our God is adamantly against one human being owning another. That our God is adamantly against degrading another, taking advantage of another. That forms of physical oppression are vile in God's eyes. That God, our God, is a God of very real, very literal, and very physical freedom. You may have noticed that when I read the names for God in our Exodus passage, instead of what the English translation translates them as, in our English Bibles, every time God's name in the Old Testament is written as Yahweh, we translate it as the Lord in all capitals, L-O-R-D, the Lord. And this is for good reason. It follows a Jewish tradition of showing respect for God, so you don't say or write God's name. Some scholars believe this is because in the ancient world, to know the name of a god meant that you could have power over that god. So the Jewish people didn't want to show respect by assuming they could have that kind of power over Yahweh. But in this passage, I think calling God the Lord, a title, gives the wrong impression for what's happening. God is saying to Moses that all of his ancestors before him only knew God by a title. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, as close as they were to God and as important as the covenants God made with them were, they only knew God by a title, El Shaddai, the God who provides, or we translate it usually as God Almighty. But now God is doing something different. God has seen the plight of the Israelites, that they are enslaved by the Egyptians, and God is so against this vile dishonor, this evil of slavery and oppression, that God is coming in full force to free them. And God wants everyone to know which God is doing the saving. Let there be no mistake, I am Yahweh. God says this to Moses 5 times in these 8 verses. I am Yahweh. God's name is revealed to Moses, and God tells him to go tell it to the Israelites, tell it to the Egyptians, because it doesn't matter who knows this name, because no one can have power over this God. And you are about to see just how powerful Yahweh is, for Yahweh's full power is unleashed on this evil of slavery. By looking back at what God did for the people of Israel and Egypt, we can better understand what God did for humanity through Jesus. So what I'm suggesting here is that the freedom Jesus brings is not just a spiritual freedom, but a holistic freedom. A freedom for our whole selves, our minds, our spirits, and our bodies. God redeems Israel from their slavery in Egypt, and through Jesus, God's power is unleashed against the realm of darkness that enslaved humanity, including physical, social, literal forms of slavery and oppression. What this teaches us is that as we look back at what happened in history through the lens of what Jesus did, we see slavery is sin. Physical oppression is evil. That the slavery is death. When Jesus freed us from slavery to sin, evil, and death, those physical and social forms of oppression were included in that. They weren't thrown out. This is a yes and story. And we see the truth of this throughout Jesus' ministry, don't we? In Luke 4, Jesus reads the word of the prophet Isaiah, claiming that they fit with his ministry. The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Jesus said, blessed are the poor in spirit, yes, and blessed are the poor. Jesus says, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, yes, and those who hunger and thirst now. Jesus healed the spiritually blind, yes, and the physically blind. Jesus came for the spiritually sick, yes, and for the physically sick. This is a yes and story. And to think that we can put the physical freedom that we see God freeing the people from in the story of Moses on the shelf because now we have Jesus and Jesus' ministry is spiritual, that misses the whole point. The freedom Jesus brings is spiritual and physical, and God wants us, God's people, to be bringers of that freedom in the world. God has always called God's people not just to focus on spiritual freedom, but recognize the physical freedom that is implied as a part of it. It's reminiscent of God's word to the Israelites in Isaiah 58, which Shane, our assistant director of student ministries, read on Ash Wednesday. Is this the kind of fast I have chosen, only a day to humble yourselves? Is it only for bowing one's head like a reed or lying in sackcloth and ashes? Is that what you call a fast, a day acceptable to the Lord? Is not this the kind of fasting I have chosen, to loose the chains of injustice and untie the cords of the yoke, to set the oppressed free and break every yoke? Is it not to share your food with the hungry and to provide the poor wanderer with shelter, to clothe the naked and not turn away anyone? As Pastor Eugene Cho has said this week, the kind of fasting God invites us to in Lent is a life broken and transformed by the things of God. Does God want repentant hearts? Yes. Does God want us to live in the spiritual freedom Jesus brings? Yes. And God says, don't just give me the spiritual. It needs to make a difference in how you live every day. This is a yes and story. And this was the point of Paul's letter to the church at Galatia, one of the primary points. They claimed to know the gospel, yet they were still insisting on social hierarchies between people in their worship services. And Paul says the truth of the gospel must make a difference in how you live, how you worship, or it isn't the gospel. In Galatians 3, 26 through 28, we read, "So in Christ Jesus, you are all children of God through faith. For all of you who were baptized into Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free, nor is there male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. If you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise." According to the Apostle Paul, social distinctions and hierarchies based on race or socioeconomic class or gender should be done away with, especially in the worship service, because Jesus' gospel has physical implications, social implications. This is not just a spiritual reality, but the freedom Jesus brings must make these literal differences in the everyday life of the church at Galatia. This is a yes and story. And I think in a lot of ways, we get this. There are a lot of reasons why I'm honored to pastor here at Glenkirk, and one of those reasons is the way that I see us living this out. At Glenkirk, we are covenant people. We're part of the Evangelical Covenant Order of Presbyterians. So we value the Old Testament. We see value in the covenants God made with God's people in the past and how we can build on those with the covenant God makes with us today. This is something Glenkirk does well. Another big reason I'm proud to call Glenkirk home is that we understand that the living out of our faith has physical implications. This congregation actually sets a new bar for me in how the church can care for the literal poor around them. I've seen this in the way that Glenkirk shows up to fill the shelves at Shepherd's Pantry, not just once a year, but all year round. In fact, today is our quarterly food drive for Shepherd's Pantry. They'll be here today. Glenkirk also cares for those around the world through our missions partners who care for the orphans and the widows and educate women and free people from sex trafficking. Glenkirk seeks to meet physical needs in opening up our campus to food packing events and 12-step groups, other church congregations, and for the homeless through winter shelter programs. I have seen the faith of Glenkirk and how this body diligently prays for one another in these weekly prayer requests that are shared and seeks to meet those needs, to be God's hands and feet, through meals brought to homes and visits to those who cannot leave their houses, blankets brought to those who are cold and the fixing of each other's leaky roofs, and caring for families with new babies and meeting of practical needs in the community. So even though these scriptures kind of lent themselves to talk about this yes and reality of the kingdom of God, in a lot of ways I feel like I'm preaching to the choir. In a lot of ways we get this. But as we are in the season of Lent, a season of reflection and repentance where God asks us to come before God and seek which ways maybe we have fallen short and repent and how we can grow in the Spirit of God, I just wonder, what more is there for us to learn? I wonder if there's something else from this yes and story of God's people that God might be calling us to live into more. I think throughout history, I think if God's people had always understood that this yes and nature of God's people means spiritual and physical freedom, that perhaps the people of the Old Testament wouldn't have needed to be reminded what a real offering is to God, that they would already have been feeding the hungry and clothing the naked and setting the oppressed free. I wonder if everyone, all God's people throughout history, had understood this physical freedom, or God's freedom implies physical freedom, Paul wouldn't have had to write the letter to the Galatians. They would have already been experiencing what it means to not have hierarchy among God's people. If all God's people had understood that freedom implies, that God's freedom implies and includes physical freedom, no Christian would have been a part of the transatlantic slave trade. If all God's people had understood that God's freedom implies and includes physical freedom, then American Christians, all American Christians, would have marched with Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. So I just wonder, and I've been praying about, in light of God's yes and story, in the season of Lent, what is our collective yes? What is it that we already believe Jesus can and does deliver us from? What is our yes? And in the season of Lent, what is our and? What might we still need Jesus to deliver us from? And as we intentionally seek God's refining power, what is it that God might be inviting us to learn? How might God might be inviting us to grow? What is our and? In what ways might God want to build upon what has come before, who we have been, what we have done, for whatever God will do next? This is a yes and story. And I don't know what that's going to be. But my prayer in the season of Lent is that this series will really help us reflect back on what God did in the story of the Exodus and seek more to understand what it is Jesus does for us today. The Exodus story sets up Moses as the prime example of that kind of deliverer that God uses to bring freedom to God's people. And the New Testament builds on that and sets up Jesus as a deliverer even greater than Moses, our deliverer. For just as God so loved Israel, that God raised up Moses to deliver them from slavery, God so loved us that God sent Jesus, God's one and only Son, to deliver us from the reign of sin and evil and death, that if we might believe, we should not perish but have eternal life. This is the gospel, the good news, that Jesus wants to deliver us, wants to give us freedom, spiritual and physical freedom. Jesus is our deliverer. This is our story. And this really is good news, isn't it? Jesus is our deliverer. Amen? Amen. Let's pray. Gracious God, we're so grateful to be your people. And in the season of Lent, we humble ourselves and just ask what it might be that you are calling us to. How is it that we can more fully live into this freedom that you bring us as your people? How might we be bringers of that freedom to those around us? I thank you, God, for this congregation, these people, and how they teach me what that looks like, and the ways that they feed the poor around them and reach out to the needy and show your love in these physical ways. I thank you. God, be with us this week. Show us your love and show us the ways that we can live into this freedom. It is in the mighty and powerful name of Jesus that we pray. Amen.
In this second Sunday in the season of Lent, we're in a series of a season of self-reflection where we're inviting God to search our hearts and our lives and to show us where we still have room to grow, what new areas of faith that he might be calling us to. And so as we prepare to celebrate the sacrament of the Lord's Supper of communion together, I'm going to lead us in a time of confession of sin. And to do that, I'm going to give us a time of silence for us to invite the Spirit to search our hearts. And then we're going to pray a prayer of confession together. And then we're going to do what's sometimes called a litany, where I say a few things and then together we all respond as we prepare to take the Lord's Supper. So let's pause in silence and invite God to search our hearts. And now let's pray this prayer of confession together. Holy and merciful God, we confess to you and to one another that we have sinned by our own fault in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart and mind and strength. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. Have mercy on us, O God. We have not listened to your call to serve as Christ served us. We have not been true to the mind of Christ. We have grieved your Holy Spirit. Together, have mercy on us, O God. We confess to you, O God, all of our past unfaithfulness, the pride, hypocrisy, and impatience in our lives. We confess to you, O God, our self-indulgent appetites and ways and our exploitation of other people. We confess to you, O God, our anger at our own frustration and our envy of those more fortunate than ourselves. We confess to you, O God, our love of worldly goods and comforts and our dishonesty in daily life and work. We confess to you, O God, our negligence in prayer and worship and our failure to commend the faith that is in us. We confess to you, O God. So accept our repentance, O God, for the wrongs we have done, for our neglect of human need and suffering, our indifference to injustice and cruelty. Accept our repentance, O God, for all false judgments, for uncharitable thoughts towards our neighbors, for our prejudice and contempt towards those who differ from us. Accept our repentance, O God. Restore us, O God, favorably hear us, O God, for your mercy is great. Now hear the words of Scripture. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Amen.
And as we think about this yes and story of God's people, the ways the Exodus story becomes our own story, I can't help but think of the bread of the communion table. For the Jewish people, the unleavened bread symbolized Israel's quick departure from Egypt, when they did not have time to allow the leaven to work through the bread and help it rise. And then, on the night he was betrayed, Jesus took that traditional unleavened bread and after giving thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples. Jesus said yes and when he took this bread that symbolized freedom in Egypt and used it to point to the new freedom that he was about to bring on the cross. For he said, "This is my body broken for you. Take and eat. And as often as you do, do so in remembrance of me."
And the same night, Jesus took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Take and drink. This is the blood of the new covenant, sealed in my blood for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." When Joseph begins playing, we're going to invite you to come forward to receive communion. I want to invite those servers who are here to go ahead and come on up now. There'll be four stations up here, and I'll invite you to come down the center aisle. All four stations are the same, so you can choose any of the four stations. We have gluten-free bread available. Just ask for it. Let us know, and we'll give you a separate gluten-free bread packet. And as people come down the center aisle to receive it, I invite you to go back to your seat and then to just pause and then take the bread, peel the top layer to take the bread, and then the next layer to drink the cup in your own time as you feel led. If you're not able to come forward, while people are coming forward, if you just raise your hand at one of our communion services in the back, we'll bring the elements to you as well. Let's commune with the Lord together. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this bread and this cup of your sacrament, the Lord's Supper. As we eat and drink by faith today, we pray that we would encounter your presence, that we would be nourished with your grace and that we would be strengthened to serve you with our whole heart, soul, strength, and mind, and to serve our neighbor as ourself. For we pray these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Thank you.
God, thank you for meeting us in this place. And thank you for the body that was offered and the blood that was shed to save us completely, body, soul, and spirit, to make for yourself a people who would represent you on this earth. We thank you for all that you've given us. We eat and drink with gratitude in the name of Christ. Amen.
Well, before the benediction this morning, just want to let you know a few things. The VBS volunteer signups are starting, so you can contact Amber Flores, or we'll have more information next week as well. And if you would like prayer this morning, there will be a few elders up here on the left in front of the platform who would love to pray with you. But now hear this benediction. May the God of freedom meet you this week. As you ponder the ways the Exodus story applies to your own, may the God of freedom minister to you and show you the ways that Jesus has delivered you and the ways that you can be a deliverer of that freedom to those around you. May the God of freedom show you just how loved you are this week. Amen. Amen. Go in peace.
There is strength within the sorrow. There is beauty in our tears. When you meet us in